The Rings of Power arrived with a massive weight of expectation. Was it going to be one show to rule them all? Obviously, the show was a prequel to The Lord of the Rings, which placed it not only in the shadow of J.R.R. Tolkien's famous fantasy masterpiece, but also in conversation with Peter Jackson's era-defining blockbuster trilogy. On top of that, there was a sense that this was a make-or-break show for Amazon Prime Video as a streaming service. The series had originated with Jeff Bezos telling his staff to bring him Game of Thrones. Discussions around the show framed it as Amazon's desperate pitch for an era-defining hit, and estimates shortly before launch placed the budget at around $715 million. To put it simply, there was a lot riding on this. So, with all that in mind, did the gambit pay off? It feels damning that the response to this is basically a shrug. First of all, let's give Rings of Power some credit for the things that it does right. The show looks expensive. The scale and spectacle are genuinely impressive, even in this blockbuster age of television. The production design is spectacular, and when it all hits, there's a sense of true majesty to the unfolding action that feels worthy of Peter Jackson. That said, the direction is a bit scattershot. Half of the season is directed by Wayne Chi Yip, who brings a flat and generic streaming aesthetic to the show that undermines the budget being spent on it. And it only serves to highlight how Peter Jackson brought so much of his own flair to the film trilogy. However, the other four episodes from directors J.A. Bayona and Charlotte Brandstrom look considerably better. In particular, Bayona brings a little bit of Jackson's B-movie aesthetic to scenes of orcs stalking through houses, while Brandstrom isn't afraid to move the camera in bold and interesting ways that draw attention to the show's lavish production and its rich texture. When The Rings of Power looks good, it looks great. Unfortunately, the show's scripting is a bit of a mess. This is particularly obvious with the pacing. Allowing for the use of maps during the early episodes, it's often difficult to get a sense of the relationship between the various plot threads, whether in terms of time or in terms of space. The pacing of the show is frankly disastrous. The show's normal protagonist, Galadriel, spends about four episodes getting on and off, and on and off, and on and off boats, so that the other plots can be lined up to synchronize with her when she arrives in Middle-earth. On the other extreme, entire plot threads like the forging of the ring or the identity of the mysterious stranger spin their wheels for extended stretches, before cramming resolution into an overstuffed series finale. The reason that the show does this is to preserve two mystery boxes, the identity of Sauron and the identity of the stranger who has fallen from the sky. And don't worry, I'm not going to spoil either of them for you now. It's very 2005 plotting. A television show built around the idea that the audience is only watching to see the mystery boxes open. And by the way, we do literally see mystery boxes open. Even if the building of the show's structure to specifically preserve those mystery boxes impedes the actual storytelling flow of the season. The Rings of Power arguably had the misfortune to premiere in close proximity to House of the Dragon, another epic fantasy television show that invites obvious comparisons. House of the Dragon is a show that excels in the areas where The Rings of Power falls short, including casting, characterization, structure, and pacing. With its somewhat uneven momentum, there is perhaps something to be said for The Rings of Power as a hangout show, but the problem is that its hangs aren't entirely consistent. Morfydd Clark is fantastic as Galadriel, but she's stuck in plots that largely seem to get stuck themselves running in place. In contrast, the plot focusing on Elrond and Durin is consistently charming, even if it's not propulsive. It's not quite an endurance test. The Rings of Power does grapple with big ideas. In some ways, the show is about the challenges of trying to construct a modern adaptation of Tolkien's work in the shadow of Jackson's adaptation, most obvious in the recurring theme of children grappling with their parents' legacy. Similarly, the show also attempts to update the War on Terror subtext that informed and shaped so much of the response to Jackson's Lord of the Rings trilogy, down to an entire thread about the botched withdrawal of an occupying force from a foreign land, which I'm sure has absolutely no relevance to current events in any way, shape, or form. The Rings of Power is an uneven and unfocused show, one that often struggles with the basics of television storytelling, leaning so hard on mystery boxes that it often sabotages its own pacing. Still, the production is impressive, and the show offers some of the best spectacle on television. If only The Rings of Power wasn't stuck going in circles. The entire first season of The Rings of Power is available to stream on Amazon Prime now.